bless you, viewers. It is well with you. I am Daria Akilude, the president of Youth Empowerment Ministry, where we run seminars, preach online, gather souls for Christ, basically for the edification of the body of Christ. Today, we shall be learning the topic Ministerial Professionalism. But before we then, let's have a short prayer. And so, Heavenly Father, we commit this ministration to you. Father, please speak to us. Take charge. Let all glory be yours. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Ministerial Professionalism. It is high time all ministers every year in the world have got to take their ministry as a profession. Until you take your ministry as a profession and your profession in ministry, you may not be making anything out of anyone there. Ministerial professionalism. Now, what is a profession? A profession is by definition a calling that requires specialized educational training that has standards of excellence and a code of conduct that sets it apart. A code of conduct that sets it apart. That's what a profession is. A profession may be defined more simply as a trade which is organized incompletely, no doubt, but genuinely for the performance of function. Historically, there were only three professions: divinity, which is the ministry, the law, and medicine. Those are the three major: divinity, which is the ministry, which has to do with God Himself, the law, and medicine. Those are the three major professions we have, but we have several other ones apart from it. So, brethren, it's high time you got to take your ministry as a profession and your profession as a ministry. Then you strike a balance. Now, you see, the modern day era of specialization has led to the development of many more professions. The ministry was considered a profession because it was a specialized job requiring intensive study. It was assumed that a minister had mastered a certain body of knowledge. A minister had mastered a certain body of knowledge, which is why you have to become a master of that ministry. Are you called into the deliverance ministry? You must be a master. Are you called into choral ministry? You must be a master. Are you called into teaching ministry just like me? You must be a master. Whatever thing you are doing, it's high time you know that you've got to be a master of it all if you want results out of it. Okay. A licensing process tested for the knowledge, skills, and temperament needed for the success in the ministry. You've got to go through some training that will grant what? Success in the ministry. What is ministry? The ministry is not merely a profession. Mm-mm, it is not. But it is certainly not less than a profession. It is not merely a profession, but it is not less than a profession. So where do we stand now? That is why as a minister, you've got a lot of things to do. Which is why Apostle Paul told the people and the church at Colossians that let him that ministers don't do it as if it is unto the Lord. Okay. One of the hallmarks of a profession is the requirement of continuing education to ensure that proper levels of excellence are maintained. You should continue in education. Schooling may stop, but education is forever. You see, you have to improve. Are you in the choral ministry? You have to read books. You have to learn more. You have to attend seminars. You have to attend concerts. Are you called into deliverance ministry? You have to learn more. You have to read books. You have to do all manners of things. A doctor friend of mine has to get 150 credit hours of continuing education during every 3-year period in order to continue practicing what? Medicine. 150 credit hours. As a minister, it is what you must continue to do, even when it is not interesting. He can get these hours in a variety of ways. He can attend classes. It's not that always standing, preaching, standing, singing, deliverance, casting out devil, binding, loosing, and all manners. It's not always like that. But you know, you also educating yourself when you attend classes, when you take online seminars, when you read and respond to journal and articles, when you participate in workshops and a number of other things. It takes its responsibility to be always learning very seriously. As a man entrusted in the care of people's lives, that is exactly how it should be. That's exactly how it should be. The hands we said we should incur into your ministry may not actually be always on the pulpit. No, that's where you're getting it wrong. Sometimes you may just go on a retreat to go and learn, to learn more. You see, whenever you stop reading, whenever you stop learning, you start dying. You start dying. May we not die in Jesus' name. So you have to incur a lot of things into it. Now, if this is proper for a medical doctor, you know, to incur 150 hours credits, my goodness, every week, then how much more a minister confronting devils and devil? When I say devils, we mean demon. When I say Satan, we mean the devil, the archangel himself, Lucifer himself. I wonder if one of the reasons that so many pastors flame out of the ministry is because they are not prepared for what it means to behave in professional manner. Professional manner. That's why I said at the beginning that your ministry must become your profession and your profession must become your ministry. Yet, the ministry is not mere profession and it is not lesser than profession. You have to get that. You have to get that. You have to get that. Okay, the level of unprofessionalism that can be found in the ministry is often appalling. The level of unprofessionalism found in the ministry is extremely appalling. Appalling. And when I say appalling, I mean appalling. Undisciplined use of time. Meetings that keep working elders out of ridiculous hours. Unnecessary meeting. Speaking unnecessary tongues, wasting away time, whiling away time, doing nothing just because you do not want another fellow minister to minister so as to not to get crowd. So you begin to minister. Oh my goodness. I'm a witness in a ministry, in a church, where two pastors are in charge of that church. It is sad to note that one pastor was so envious of his second pastor, and one of the days when he has to minister, the one who he hates, he has to go to the engine room. I don't know how he did the mixer and the engine and all those. Till today, it never worked again. What a minister! It's not a professional. That, and it is appalling, extremely appalling. Shoddy work ethics, little interest in continuing education, poor preparation, just carry your Bible and go to the people. No preparation. The ministration is watery, not adding life to it. Carelessness. All these things can be found routinely in the ministry, and are one reason why the ministry itself is not viewed as a viable option by many talented young men today. Why? Because those that are there, their disposition is appalling. It's quite appalling. Professionalism is widely acknowledged as being an integral part of a variety of occupations and vocations. To be in a particular line of work, it is important for a person to be part of their professional body. What part of the professional body do you belong? What part of the ministerial body do you belong? Who mentors you? Who do you follow? Who do you learn from? In New Zealand, there are at least 53 professional bodies that ensure their members are recognized as professionals in their respective field. However, being in pastoral ministry is not on that list. In the eyes of the world, pastoral ministry does not have the same status of professionalism as other vocations. No. It doesn't have the same status of professionalism as other vocations. Yet, historically, pastoral ministry was seen as one of four major vocations, four
major vocations, the ministry, the first part. First major vocation. Look at it now. This is responsibility, code of ethics, honesty, fairness, respect. Code of ethics is what is key. If you don't comply with the codes and conduct of the ministry, it is, my goodness, it's quite a disappointment.